When I grow up, I want to work for a woke company.
Like super woke.
When I grow up, I want to be hired based on what I look like.
Rather than my skills.
I want to be judged
by my political beliefs.
I want to get promoted
based on my chromosomes.
When I grow up,
I want to be offended
by my coworkers
and walk around the office
on eggshells
and have my words policed
by HR. Words like
grandfather,
peanut gallery,
long time no see,
no can do.
When I grow up,
I want to be obsessed with emotional safety
and do workplace sensitivity training
all day long.
When I grow up, I want to climb the corporate ladder.
Just by following the crowd.
I want to be a conformist.
I want to weaponize my pronouns. What are pronouns?
It's time to grow up and get back to work. Introducing the number one woke-free job board in America, redballoon.work.
Hey, y'all. Welcome to Cosmopolitic on the Fight Lab Feast Network. Pastor Toby Tuck Knox. I'm the water boy. It's good to be with you. It's Reformation Week. We're just turning this into Reformation Week.
Well, except for Reformata Day.
Week.
Maybe month.
Oh. Well, we live in it, so why not?
Yeah. Our Fight Laugh Feast magazine is a quarterly issue that packs a punch like a 21-year Balvini. No ice. You know, I had somebody come up to me, I think at the conference or somewhere. No, I think it was actually at this... at the Reformation party I went to this last weekend at a church
in Kansas.
Kansas.
Our boy, our Kansas boys.
Yeah, Christ Church Leavenworth. And guy came up to me after church and said, I bought my first bottle of 21-year Balvini just because of your ad.
Oh, man, we should have got paid off
that. No, is subscribe to the magazine.
Right.
You heard the wrong thing.
I forgot to ask him if he'd actually subscribed to the magazine, but like he was like, that's man, funny. You weren't kidding. 21-year Balvini
is a
different thing. Yeah.
By the way, I haven't gotten my new magazine yet. Where's my magazine?
It's coming. Everyone else has got it except for us in our office.
In that case,
I used to have a subscription, didn't I? It's come to my house before.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Great. Glad we had this conversation. We don't water down our scotch. Why would we water down our theology? Order a yearly subscription for yourself and then send a couple yearly subscriptions to your friends who've been drinking lukewarm evangelical Kool-Aid. Yuck. Every quarter, we promise quality food for the soul, wine for the heart, and some Red Bull for turning over tables, even though I don't really like Red Bull very much. Our magazine will include cultural commentary. It does include that. A Psalm of the Quarter, recipes for feasting, laughter, just sprinkled throughout the glossy pages, like some of that, your favorite, you know, rub that you put on the meat before you put it in the smoker. And just, that kind of laughter.
I made some good meat smoke last week. Oh,
man, so sign up today at fightlaughfeast.com. Get your magazine and maybe it'll come to you.
If you're an author, you might get.
How you going to make some good food and you ain't going to bring it in and share?
Oh, yeah, man, right. I made
what kind of roll trash is
this? What kind of Fight Laugh Feast is this?
We bought half a cow from this Down syndrome kid. Who loves raising cows and butchering them,
and like does a great job. Ministry, huh?
He does a great job, and the meat has been fantastic. Amazing.
And did you bring beef ribs?
Did you bring any?
No, I didn't. Maybe someday.
Why don't you bring some and share with your friends?
Hey, I got one other plug before you get going. So Jason Farley. So we rebooted. Fight Left East University into Pub University. You know, Pub University. And so Jason Farley's actually teaching an apologetics course. Okay. It actually starts on September 14th.
No, I think are you sure September?
Because November 14th. Oh my goodness. November 14th. And then it's basically going to go through about December 21st. So it's, you know, these little Pub U courses are
how many weeks
a month long. It's about 4 weeks.
4 weeks. Okay.
Nice. And two times per week are the classes, and they're for your family.
Mm-hmm.
So you can sign your family up and it's $199 per, you know, household.
Yeah.
And you get a Zoom link and then everybody gets to participate.
Gather around.
And it's been fantastic. Yeah. I mean, all the Pub University courses have been sold out basically.
And he's changing, I think, from apologetics. He's going to do the importance of the family. So he's going to work through that. So it's going to
importance of the family.
Yeah, what? I believe so.
I have two classes here. Yeah,
I think
him.
There's apologetics and the importance of the family. I think he's switched
the mission
which one's
of God
first.
For the family.
That's what it is. That's
all right,
what
let me,
he's
let
doing.
Me text him real quick. We'll be clear up on our website. On what he's doing.
But I saw the outline for that one, yeah. And I might have told him that he needed to do that one first.
All right. So this is Reformation Week, Reformation Month. This is Reformation Year. This is Reformation
Era
Life. Yeah. And every Reformation. Includes both tearing down and building up. We have to have both. It's necessary to have both. We're tearing down sin. We're tearing down idols. Right. We're tearing down the monuments and the institutions that were built to idols.
Well, I thought it was all spiritual. No, it's not.
Yeah, no.
Okay. Sorry.
Let me finish.
Modern evangelicalism.
And it's also then building, because as you tear down the sin, you put on obedience. You tear down the sin, you put on righteousness. You put on obedience to the word of God. Yeah. And then you build institutions where that obedience is lived out. Your marriage.
And government.
Your family. And that's right. And your business and your school and your church and your cities and your nations then are built out in obedience to God. So it's always tearing down and building up. And you know, the world understands this.
Yeah.
Sometimes
better than
churches.
Yeah.
So for example, one congressman wants to build this.
I've introduced a bill to have an LGBTQI+ museum on the Smithsonian here in Washington, D.C. This is a museum much like we've done to recognize African Americans, Native Americans, Latinos, and most recently, Asian Americans. It's a way to really recognize our community and to be able to recognize it and look at its history and look at all aspects of treatment of this country, both good and bad. And this legislation would start the process so that we could also have a museum dedicated to the LGBTQI+ community.
So he gets it.
He's trying to reform
America.
Mm-hmm. And build a memorial.
He's building an institution, a memorial.
On the backs of black people.
Right.
He's jamming.
Look, show me your slave ships. Show me your whipping blocks. Mm-hmm. Stop trying to piggyback on everything that black people have done. And now, and so they're cashing in on it.
Yeah.
And it's really disappointing that a lot of the groups that are supposed to be so pro-black are missing out on how they're getting stuffed by the LGBTQ movement and getting played by them.
That's right.
They're going to get the government to build a whole. I just was watching a clip the other day of somebody talking about what Obama did for black people. And there was a group of black people looking and trying to figure out like what was the benefits of having a black president.
Yeah.
And there was one gay person that said, I don't know about y'all, but we did pretty good.
Yeah.
Oof.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the whole room got really quiet because they exactly.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So like it wasn't anything that and they're doing it again.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean
and what is that plus?
Yeah, that was the other thing. It's like,
right.
Aren't we? I mean, now they're not just going to destroy the whatever is historical about the black narrative, as if to say it's the same thing as the LGBTQ narrative, and it's not at all. You ain't got no slave ships.
Right. Yeah. Right. Well, they do have like sadomasochistic rituals.
They have those.
Well, right? And one is not the other.
Right. I know.
Right? Black people were created in the image of God.
Right.
And your sexual abominative acts are not black people. Like, are not
abominative.
And they're trying to say that, like this that is that's the new this is the new black.
Yeah.
And it's not.
No, no, Gabe's not the Gabe's not the new black. Either.
No, that's true. Gabe is not.
What?
Although,
just for the record, but you know, the other thing that I hate about this is that they're all the other, you know, so it's the, you know, black, Latino, Asian,
they're all
getting played and they're all getting used as if it's the same thing, which it's absolutely not. But the thing is when you build an institution, when you build a memorial, when you build a museum in a nation, there's a right way to honor particular people in a way that recognizes that God is told a story that has blessed all of us.
Right.
Yeah.
And so we have all been, we all inherit both the challenges that came with the slave trade and slavery and racial tensions and so on. Yeah. But then we all have inherited a huge blessing in how God has been working through that story through there. But that whole point, that it's, the whole play there is to actually not to unite us. It's to divide us.
Yeah.
It's to take these things and say now we need another category, need another category, which ultimately divides us all. But in the process of building one kind of memorial to this leftist reformational project. You may have noticed in the news recently that they've also been tearing down memorials and actually literally melting them down.
This is Robert E. Lee.
This is Robert E. Lee's face.
Well, and it seems to me there's no video there, Toby.
I know. I'm just looking.
He looked over like I thought there's a video. But it seems to me, though, to your point, that the world, everybody wants to build memorials. It's like almost an innate human cultural or communal desire.
Right. Because God made the world in such a way that it's full of signs and symbols.
Yeah.
Of reality that point to realities bigger than themselves.
Yeah. Well, and there's something else here too. This is not just, I think that's going on, but this is a play that runs really well on the ignorance of people. When you've been trained and educated by government education, then when you see something like this, you cheer.
Right.
Yeah. People have no concept of who he is. Right. You know, people think of, oh, this is just a guy who owned slaves, and he was on the other side of the fight.
He fought in the war to defend slavery.
He lost in the war.
And he lost in the war. And this is right here. The reason people love his statue is because they want the South shall rise again, and they want to bring slavery back.
Right.
And that's what they think this is all about. Right. People have no idea what kind of person is this? Was a Christian man who was really, I think you posted the quote of it, but he was like, hey, if I had all the slaves, I would free him so we wouldn't have to go to war.
Right, yeah.
He's a guy who was like, I want slavery to end, and I want it to end the proper way, the proper channels. Right. He voted against the secession.
Right.
He didn't want to do this. This wasn't what he was about. Right. And yet, because he understood his oaths and who he was tied to and the people he was with, he fought there and he freed his slaves before they even went into war. Yeah. And so we have no concept for a man like Robert E. Lee in our current time. Right. We can't see a man that has that where it's messy and he's still being faithful.
Right. We can't imagine.
Right.
We can't imagine that there could be a worse form of slavery.
Right.
Yeah.
But I think that's what Lee actually saw.
We appreciate some of it because we think it's freedom.
Yeah. I mean, what do you call it when somebody puts a gun to your head and says you can't leave?
Yeah.
Well, that's called slavery.
Yeah.
And ever since the War of Northern Aggression.
Amen. Amen.
No state has been free to leave.
I found out it was the Civil War, like when I left Texas.
People like
the War of Northern Aggression.
Right.
Yeah. There's a lot of things people found out late in Texas, like June 2. I ain't just gonna say
you're free.
But this goes back to memorials. Like we erect memorials and we tear down memorials, and it's like very connected, kind of like to our spiritual state. Like,
this is religion.
This is total religion.
This is religion in the public square.
That's right.
What are we gonna honor?
Is it neutral?
No. What are we gonna honor? What are we going to tell our kids about?
That's right.
What are we going to raise them up in? And what are we going to destroy and tell the kids, hey, this is a cautionary tale. Don't ever want to become like this guy.
This is a priesthood of the public square.
Right. And then this even frames, you know, what we laugh about. I mean, Colbert is bringing up Mike Johnson.
Praise God.
And I know this is part of the...
You know, Kevin McCarthy did not get this treatment.
I know. This is encouraging. Speaker. This is strangely encouraging.
It is.
We're learning more about the new Speaker of the House, Louisiana Congressman Mike Johnson, seen here...
Wow.
They already know the liturgy.
Seen here showing the size of a fish he recently baptized. If the Bible is his worldview on any issue, I don't know why progressives are nervous. He's clearly going to ask the rich to sell all their possessions and give the money to the poor.
Did you do it, Stephen?
That's really...
Did you do it, Stephen?
Good for him. Good for you. Good for you. And, like, you know, being biblically faithful is not easy for a guy from Louisiana because now he has to give up shrimp, crab, oysters, and barbecued pork.
Yeah. That's funny.
And I'm sure he's going to miss his wife when she has to be cast out of town during the time of her blood, only to be allowed to return when she brings two turtle doves to the tabernacle for the priest to sacrifice. You know... issues.
Did Stephen sell all his goods? I mean, Stephen's rich.
I think that was more anti-Semitic than he thought.
It could be.
That might be more anti-Jewish than he thought. I don't know.
I also think that's more Bible than most Christians got this last week at church.
That's true. At least what we hope comes from Mike Johnson is that he stops the government from stealing from the poor. Yeah. That'd be really nice.
Has the government sold all that it has?
Who's the richest fat man in the room?
Yeah, the government.
It's definitely the government. The government. Absolutely, right? Yes. Yeah.
But the thing that I noticed about him is he wants to pick and choose which verses he cares about.
Right.
So clearly he's mocking somebody like Mike Johnson, right. You know, because he, you know, believes in Old Testament Bible verses, but he just started off with saying, so are all the rich people going to sell everything and give it to the poor?
Right.
And he hasn't.
But regardless of what he's done, like, I'm just saying, like, is the Bible authoritative or not?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If it's not, then who cares?
Yeah.
And if it, but here's the thing, Colbert, actually a couple of years ago, posted a video. There was an interview with him talking about him kind of like
articulating the gospel pretty well,
expressing faith in God and the Christian
He's
God.
Some sort of Catholic, I think.
Yeah, I think some kind of vague Christian. I mean, it was some recognition of the importance of grace and forgiveness.
Yeah.
And I think, I mean, I took it relatively sincerely.
Yeah.
So I think he knows some parts of the Bible have to be true.
Right.
But I also think, unfortunately, he's been discipled by the modern church, which has told him that you can pick and choose.
Right.
That there are certain verses that are somehow self-evidently true, like rich people sell everything, give them to the poor, and it just happens to line up with Marxism.
Right.
What Bible verse is that?
But other Bible verses I don't know which ones that we would catch him on.
Yeah.
But like, you know, is it, you know, what about abortion? What about adultery? What about homosexuality? Yeah, Jesus says in the beginning he made them male and female, not third or fourth sex or gender.
They never did this to Ilhan Omar. They never made fun of the Quran like this. You never know that? They never did it to a squad.
Or their clear anti-Semitism.
But that's okay. I like the conversation.
Yeah, I do too.
I want to have the conversation these terms.
Because I think the fact of the matter is I mean, and he's going to mock this in a second, but again, religion in the public square is inescapable.
Yeah. Yes.
But you can tell which gods are being honored by
memorials.
By the memorials.
Because they're picking and choosing memorials.
Exactly.
We don't want Robert E. Lee, but we have Lenin somewhere in America.
And by which statues are getting torn down and burned down.
Right.
And you better believe that if someone melted down a statue of Muhammad.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
There would be that we would have mostly peaceful protests
right.
all over again, all summer of it,
as we're getting right now from a bunch of people, you know, defending Hamas.
That's right.
But roll the next clip.
That Hannity interview wasn't the first time Johnson advocated for his idea of a Christian government. This is him on the House floor just 6 months ago.
Jefferson clearly did not mean that metaphorical wall was to keep religion from influencing issues of civil government. To the contrary, it was meant to keep the federal government from impeding the religious practice of citizens. The founders wanted to protect the church from an encroaching state, not the other way around.
Exactly. You can read all about it in Jefferson's famous essay, "Yeah, I didn't mean that." Obviously, what he's saying is a crazy interpretation of the separation of church and state. Jefferson's used that wall metaphor because a wall is closed off to both sides. You don't want politics in your church, but if you let church into your politics, you end up with guys like Mike Johnson representing the church to young people, and they're all going to say, "No thanks, Jesus," no matter how fun it is at youth pastor Ricky's Leviticus karaoke night.
Leviticus karaoke night.
Notice, he cares about Jesus. He cares about people knowing about Jesus. Like, he's actually making fun of, like, he doesn't want crazy youth pastors who have karaoke night with Leviticus.
But how does that work?
But he wants this.
I do chapter 18.
He wants a false version of Jesus, an incomplete version of Jesus, and not the true Jesus.
That's not Kyperion.
Yeah.
Because he's like separation of politics and religion.
And that's the thing is, and I think,
we want the same thing too, though.
Yeah, I was going to say, actually, I think what Mike Johnson's getting at is the fact that the founders never dreamed of separating a Christian faith from the state, but they did want a separation between the institution of church and state. And I don't know what the rest of the clip was that Mike Johnson was talking, and maybe he goes on to explain that clearly, but it's true that there is a separation between the institution of church. We don't want pastors running the government, and we don't want government officials running the church.
Right.
But that does not mean that there's no neutrality in the public square. You are always honoring some God.
Yeah.
Well, and
you are always building something under according to a worldview that sees the world in a certain way, and Colbert wants that too. Like, yeah. I mean, Colbert wants institutions that reflect a certain kind of morality.
That's well, right. Yeah, he just pointed to that right. in the beginning when he says, "I guess we're going to have all the rich people now sell right. their stuff and give it to the poor."
Exactly. So, right? So is that moral?
Right. Exactly.
Is that actually moral? And according to who? And I would guess he would say, "Well, according to Jesus, according to the way that I read the Bible."
Yeah.
But that's picking and choosing. Rather than letting the word of God speak for itself, all of scripture, and then you've got to dump it all on the table, and then you've got to let it sort it out.
Historically, I'm not for us making up our own form of morality.
No.
Just saying. Don't go well
no,
for us.
No.
We don't do so
the Bible's good. Our anchor.
But ultimately, this is going to go back to actually what we talked about at the Fight Left East conference and the Ark Encounter just a couple weeks ago. This goes back to the doctrine of creation. That's and right. Thankfully, Mike Johnson knows that,
and so does Stephen.
Colbert was the punching for it.
Johnson is so Bible-y, he helped get public funding for an organization called Answers in Genesis,
Yay.
Which believes the earth is only 6,000 like years old, so they could get public funding to build a theme park in Kentucky What's called the Ark Encounter, a life-size Noah's Ark Museum.
Yep.
Don't forget to visit the gift shop where you can pick up those adorable salt shakers filled with Lot's actual wife.
Now, they didn't have those.
That's funny. No, they didn't. But that was funny.
According to the literature, the museum is a place where children can learn that dinosaurs were passengers on the Ark. Yes.
They were.
Many early humans had dinosaurs as pets. It's right there in the book of Hanna-Barbera. And the Lord spake to Hezekiah, have thou a yabba-dabba-doo time. A dabba-doo time. We'll have a gay old... Wait, not that part. Wilma! It's a living. And lest you think Mike Johnson was just some lawyer representing a client there, here he is talking about the Ark Encounter on his podcast.
The Ark Encounter is one way to bring people to this recognition of the truth that, you know, what we read in the Bible.
I mean, stop for a second. I mean, we didn't know this is all going to happen.
Right.
But, like, notice, we had a conference a couple weeks ago at the Ark Encounter entitled The Politics of Six-Day Creation.
Yeah.
Okay. The politics of six-day creation.
And look at the liberals make the connection.
Yeah, I mean, and I mean, it was packed, and a whole bunch. I mean, it's you know, the returns have been great, and I think the speakers were amazing. We're going to show you a clip in a second of Ken Ham's talk. But we got to get this in our bones. All of God's word. You cannot pick and choose. Now, are there answers to the questions of can Mike Johnson have shellfish? Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, let's talk about this.
It's in the Bible.
Actually, in the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit shows this vision to Peter where all these unclean animals are let down in a sheet, and God says, what I've made clean, do not declare unclean. It was a symbol of the separation between Jews and Gentiles, which are now reconciled in the gospel. So, like, I mean, in one sense, I don't blame Colbert because I think he's been discipled by the modern church.
Yeah.
The modern church has taught him, you know, aka Andy Stanley, whatever.
There's a Catholic priest, Andy Stanley.
Yeah, there is. I'm sure. But
we call him the Pope.
You can unhitch. You can unhitch the Old Testament from the New Testament, and actually, turns out you can unhitch whatever verse you want from whatever verse you want.
Yeah.
If it seems to get in the way of you sharing grace or forgiveness or reaching the lost, which fundamentally, ultimately, when you get there, what you've reached them with. Is empty. You've not reached them with the truth of the gospel. You've reached them with your feelings. You've reached them with whatever is popular. But I just think it's interesting that, you know, Colbert is bringing this up about this new House Speaker.
Yeah. Well, and is that just bringing it up? But it's a fear of how the rest of the nation is going to be governed because a guy believes his Bible.
Exactly.
Because the Speaker of the House, who has no authority,
is so Bible-y,
you know,
and believes Genesis 1:1 all the way to the whole Ark and stuff.
Yeah.
Right? So he really believes his Bible. Yeah. That's the setup.
Yeah.
And notice, this is getting so much publicity because Ken Ham built an Ark.
A memorial.
He built something and said, I'm going to bring the whole world to see it. Yep. You can't miss this. I mean, how many people? 1.3 million people a year, and 300,000 or 400,000 of them are not Christians.
Yeah.
I mean, you can mock it.
Yeah.
You can make fun of it, but you can't ignore it.
Yep.
And I think this is why we've been talking about we love what Ken Ham has done. With Answers in Genesis and the Ark Encounter is he's a model for Christians. Look, Reformation is you tearing down idols
right.
and building memorials and institutions.
Right. How much of that would have cost?
What? How much of what?
How much?
If, the Ark Encounter?
No. If he tried to pay for a commercial to be on.
Oh, yeah.
And how much of that would have cost? Yeah. And get Stephen Colbert to read your commercial
free
for you.
Free advertising.
Yeah, that is free marketing. Free right. People, let me tell you something. Everybody gets it really wrong on the internet when it comes to marketing.
Yeah.
They think if I actually talk out about something, what I'm going to do is push that information down and nobody's going to see it and nobody's going to want it anymore.
Yeah.
That's not how the internet works. It's not how the new form of media works. When you talk about something, you amplify it.
Yep.
You bring it up.
And when people mock it,
it gets further.
Scorn it.
Yes.
And try to tear it down. The Book of Acts, I've said this many times on the show, the Book of Acts is evangelism by riot.
Yeah.
Evangelism by controversy. This is the plan. Now, we're not to be jerks. We're not to become spectacles for immoral reasons.
Right.
But when the truth requires it, when obedience requires it, and you stand out there and you say it, and they mock you, and they hate you, and they spit on you, you say, this is the plan.
Yep. Yep.
And there in that moment, God pours his grace on you, and it puts a spotlight on you, mm-hmm. and Colbert is mocking you, and you smile, mm-hmm. and you say, yep, I believe in Jesus. I believe the whole Bible, and this is good for the world.
I think a fun play to be running right now would be, you know, buy some sort of property, turn it into some sort of memorial park.
Yeah.
Where you take a lot of these statues that have been torn down, melted, rebuild them or whatever, like Robert E. Lee, you know, get Margaret Sanger with all these babies at her feet, you know, build memorials that actually that tell our creepy. Story of American history.
Right.
Yeah. And what we've done, but tell it God's way.
Yeah.
Not man's way. Let's not build LGBT memorials.
That's right. We want to build memorials like Ken Ham has built.
That are making arguments that, LGBT community, who we choose to have sex with is like the black man's plight.
Right. Right. I also want to mention, though, that we are making memorials all day long, every day. In how you love your wife.
That's right.
How you respect your husband, how you train up your children, mm-hmm. how you do your work, your vocation, how you go to work, how you do your job, how you work with excellence. What you are building is constantly what you're shaping and forming is people and institutions.
Right.
And those people and institutions, churches, schools, businesses, cities, museums, whatever.
Yep.
You're building things that either reflect the glory of the triune God or not.
Right.
And meanwhile, you're tearing down institutions. You're tearing down sin. You're tearing down as you repent of sin, as you say, oh, we got to get rid of that idolatry of athletics and sports that's been creeping in on Lord's Day worship.
Yep.
We got to get rid of this materialism that's been causing me to think more of, you know, modern therapeutic, counseling stuff. Like, this is your ism that you have, rather than recognizing that it's sin.
Yeah.
You need to tear down man's word.
Yep.
And instead put in place of it God's word as the foundation for everything. And actually, Ken Ham nailed this
at our conference
at the Ark Encounter.
Because what has happened is generations of kids have been told that we can't trust Genesis 1-11, and they've been told you believe what the secular world believes. They go to Christian colleges and the professors say, yeah, we don't believe Genesis 1-11. The devil knows, how do you get rid of the Christian worldview? You got to get rid of the foundation. If you undermine the foundation, the structure collapses. Mm. If you take away the foundation of a house, the structure collapses. Not only has the world attacked Genesis 1-11, but much of the church has, and now we have generations who don't know how to deal with these issues up here or succumb to them because they've been allowed to have this foundation and the church has reinforced you can have this foundation. Yep. And what our ministry is all about is helping to raise up generations with the right foundation of God's word in Genesis 1-11 who know what they believe, know why they believe what they do, equipped with answers, apologetics to defend the Christian faith, know that we have to deal foundationally with the battle down here because until people change their foundation to here, then we can't deal with these issues. These issues are an outworking of the wrong foundation. And that's really the message I wanted to bring to you this morning, and that is that we need to make sure that we are not compromising God's word. We need to make sure we're not taking ideas from outside of Scripture to Scripture. We need to make sure we're not putting our trust in man. Over and over and again in the Old Testament, we see this message, stop putting your trust in man. Some trust in chariots. We trust in the word of God. Stop putting your trust in man. Don't trust man's word. You put your trust in God's word. And Unfortunately, our church today is very lukewarm overall, and the reason it's lukewarm because they gave up biblical authority, put their trust in man, no different than the Israelites compromising with the pagan religion of the age, the Canaanites and all the rest of it. And now you see those churches that don't stand on Genesis 1 to 11, soft on LGBT, soft on abortion, soft on the gender issue, and people, I'll guarantee those churches that are soft on those issues, caving to those issues, do not believe in a literal Genesis 1 to 11, because as soon as you believe in a literal Genesis 1 to 11, God made marriage. There's only one marriage, a man and a woman. God made man, male and female. There's only two genders, a male and female. You can't trust your feelings because sin has affected us. We need to judge what we believe against the absolute authority of the Word of God, and that's the message we need to be giving to generations and raising up generations on the right foundation, equipped to defend the Christian faith so they can stand in this world like Daniel stood in Babylon and did not compromise. That's what we need to do.
That's what Stephen Colbert needs to hear. Yeah. But unfortunately, our church
didn't come to our conference.
And we'll get him next year.
He got his chance.
Home, it's where you build your legacy, where traditions are started, seeds are planted, meals are shared, and stories are told. Home is where you prepare to go out into the world. Home is one of those essential institutions, memorials that we build that proclaims the triune God. Finding the home that's perfect for your family is a big job. Story Real Estate is Moscow, Idaho's top real estate team. They give people real estate advice all over the country, family homes, investments, land, new construction, or commercial. They know real estate. If you've thought about a move to Moscow or anywhere in the country for that matter, reach out and get connected with a Story Real Estate agent. Wherever you're going, they can help guide you home. So visit storyrealestate.com, storyrealestate.com today.
And Ken is absolutely right. The politics of six-day creation matters, and it matters and ultimately on the authority of God's word.
Yeah, and what you're going to build.
Yeah.
If you're on the authority of God's word, you build monuments and businesses and institutions to proclaim that.
You can go to FLFPUB.com, FLFPUB.com, and finish listening to all of the talks that are there. Yeah.
The whole talk was a banger.
The conference, everything was good.
Ken's Ham's talk made me a little mad.
Oh, really?
I'm just going to leave that there.
Okay.
I'm going to leave that
there. Right. Not because of Ken. Because of the Christian church.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. That's 100%.
All right. If you're single, get married. If you're married, have you some kids. And if you have kids, go baptize them. Until tomorrow, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Go fight, laugh, and feast. This is Crust Politic.
It is the duty of the free man to resist tyranny at every turn. Every man will either watch his freedom stripped away or take action to protect what he loves. Introducing the A3, the newest revolutionary body armor from Armored Republic. The A3 is the new standard for lightweight multi-hit body armor. A3 plates are incredibly light at 4.6 pounds. The patented design captures fragmentation while remaining multi-hit capable. The A3 will stop up to M80 ball, yet comes in at only 0.7 inches thick. The A3 is the thinnest NIJ.06 compliant or certified composite standalone plate that includes the drop test. The A3 is the first of its kind, patent pending, that combines an alloy strike face with polyethylene backing, revolutionizing body armor technology by providing strength and durability while remaining sleek and maneuverable. The A3 is the new standard in lightweight body armor. The fight against tyranny just got stronger.